Hi everybody, Dr. A with some more toxicology basics. We're going to look at drug of abuse testing, and this video is going to be about just why do we test. So testing for drugs of abuse, or what we call drugs of abuse screening, is done to detect the presence of both legal and illegal substances. The typical sample used is urine. They can be performed for many reasons, including clinical or medical care. So somebody comes in, they're passed out, and you want to know if they've taken anything. So poisoning and overdoses, that would be medical reasons to do that, or they're acting really weird, right? Then, of course, pre-employment. There are some facilities that absolutely must have employees that are drug-free. And so they can, screen employees if that's an employment requirement. Post-accident evaluation, especially people that drive and under the DOT regulations, so they drive trucks and stuff or delivery vehicles, and it was an accident, they need to mostly be clear, show that they have been cleared and they didn't have any drugs on board, basically. And that they were not impaired in their driving. And also random monitoring of employees in the workplace if those employees or that workplace is a drug-free workplace, drug-free zone. So this would be then after they've been employed for a while, they can randomly check. I know that in the healthcare world, they can do that, especially if they suspect that the employee might be under the influence of certain drugs, or even sometimes stealing patient medications, especially pain medications. So I've seen that personally happen. And so they can screen them randomly if there's any suspicion, especially if patient medications have been going missing. So also we can do testing for setting bail or sentencing, and identifying substance abusers for treatment, or monitoring inmates or parolees to ensure abstinence from drug in the criminal justice system. So that's another area that, they need drug testing. The detection of performance-enhancing drugs in sports. So that's another reason we may do. And those tests are going to be often beyond what your typical pre-employment screen is going to be. And then, of course, also post-mortem analysis to help determine the cause of death and a suspicious death. So each reason for testing drugs of abuse has its own requirements, and those are in regards to what's to be included in the panel, right? Because there's a variety of panels out there. How quickly are the results needed? In a clinical situation, if you have a patient that's unconscious, you want those results as fast and as soon as possible. But the ones that are maybe like a post-accident, or the one with compliance within the justice system, maybe, a day or two turnaround time is fine. So, and then how specific and sensitive should the assay be? So, how specific means is a drug or its metabolite detected when they are present? So what's it picking up, right? And some of that is, sometimes there's some cross reactivity, so there are other things that could trigger the test to be positive. And then how sensitive? What's the lowest amount of the drug that can be detected? So that's sensitivity. And then there are legal requirements. Some drug screens, especially workplace testing, testing of federal employees, and some that are legal, medical but legal, have strict guidelines or chain of custody that has to be followed and documented from the specimen collection through the interpretation and the reporting of the results. And this is to maintain the validity of the sample and its results, and it can stand up in court. And that process usually includes a witness collection where the patient or the donor signs off on and labels and initials the specimen and some paperwork, and the collector does so at the same time. And then the collector takes it, and then like the person that, if it has to be shipped, the person that picks it up has to sign a form. So meaning they're the ones who handle it for shipping, and then when it gets to the testing facility, the person that is going to process the sample and test the sample, they have to sign, and if that person is the same that's reporting, then they have to sign like who's reporting, or if it's a different person that's reporting the test. So they, you should be able to, basically, with the chain of custody documents, if the proper protocols have been followed, document everybody that has touched a specimen from the time it was collected till the time the results have been reported out. So it's important that the ordering physician, law enforcement representative, forensic professional, government entity, insurance agent, employer, sports organization, and a person being tested understand what is included in the drug screen, how the specimen is handled, how testing is performed, and how the results may or may not be interpreted. So it's not nearly as simple as simply saying, hey, give me some urine and we're just going to test it for drugs. That's like way too vague. And we usually need to know specifically what is being looked for. So some of the club drugs, such as methylenedioxymethamphetamines, or MDMA, or ecstasy, and flunitrazepam, which is a date rape drug, rohypnol, could be difficult to detect, and they would need specialized assays. And so available assays don't always detect a drug, especially the designer drugs that have been even like modified beyond those. They're new, or the drug does not remain in the body long enough to be detected. So GHB is one of those. It clears the body pretty quickly. All right, that wraps up a little bit on why to test. Follow up the next video on the procedures and protocols.